Mr. Investor, welcome back to the channel, baby. Cedric 111 said, OGM reveals what this company's made of.
Dollar bill, y'all.
And this guy said some true words. You buy under $7 and you buy better than many institutions. Under $7 is a gift. Accept it with gratitude. What's up, baby? Pop that collar. Today, we're going to be talking about bio-nanogenomics. We'll also be talking about what's going on in the world of genomics, the game plan, and how I think bio-nanogenomics, we have everything to look forward to, including 9 out of 10 growth. But before we get into this video, please remember, none of this is financial advice. It's for entertainment only. If you'd like to support the channel, please click the join button above my head, or if you want to send me a donation, in the description box is my PayPal link. I love and appreciate you guys, and if you can't send any of those, please just hit the thumbs up. I love y'all and I appreciate y'all. First things first, bingo bango, we were down at $5. I think it was 17 the other day, or 14. Apparently $5.14 according to Google in that dippity dip. Today we nearly touched 6. We got quite high, $5.96 or so. Well, the more bingo stock drops, the more I continue to accumulate shares. Talking about accumulating shares, I want to show you what the institutions have been up to, and I just want to show you a few fintel pages
in the timeline of bingo.
You know me, I'm tabalicious, baby. We got a tab here from a few weeks ago when Bionanogenomics had 154 institutional owners, about 17.67% institutional ownership. And if we look at a more recent one, take a look at this. We then leaped over the last few days, the last week or so, we leapt over 200. So we have 216 institutional owners. This was probably a few days ago. Now,
hiya! See that karate chop? We got 245, and magic, just like that, 245 institutions.
Who remembers when I was covering this before and we had only 69? With institutional ownership, they're saying that, you know, institutional shares 33.64% at this moment in time. But some of our boys over on StockTwits, Brennan Messenger of Moiseville,
like,
he's saying that Lope believes Cantaloupe that true institutional ownership is probably now over 40%.
Bingo cowboys, yeehaw!
I also like the fact that you picked up on this as well, Brennan, if you're watching this. Customer presentations. That's 11 customer presentations by Nanogenomics showing optical genome mapping data. This is over 3 major clinical areas of application from 10 institutions and 6 countries. Talking about countries,
the big daddy Eric Holmlin, where you been?
Well, right now he's talking about Ronaldo, but a few days ago, Eric was actually in France. He was doing a class. I think he was doing some sort of exercise class. Looked like it might be a, don't know, kind of circuit class, but he was over in France for business maybe. And now he's in Belgium. So what do you think he's doing over there, man? He might be spreading a little bit of
magic over in Belgium in a spa.
You might be making those sales, closing those customer sales, or visiting potential clients.
Sapphire, baby. Show them Cytopia.
And Vince, my friend, don't think I forgot about you, baby. You sent me this months ago when Bionanogenomics was exploring some more plants, man. Some of that janky. This more recent study, not danky, but they were actually looking at camptothecin. So camptothecin, what is this drug? Well, it was discovered by Mr. M.E. Wall and M.C. Wanny, and they were looking for natural products that can be used for anti-cancer drugs.
So they came across this mystical tree
where you could get this camptothecin, and this comes from the bark and stem of the Camptotheca acuminata. This is a tree native to China, and it's used in traditional Chinese medicine.
Oh my god, there's so many of me, we doubled up. Double the yeehaw!
So the other day, this company actually popped off. I'm not investing in this company. I have no shares in this company whatsoever, and I'm not particularly interested, but I just wanted to show you guys. Region Cell Bioscience Holdings. Across a month, I think it went from $6.30 and it reached a high of actually $59. I think this was a few days ago, and I think it was on that Wednesday. Word on the curb, it was a juicy short squeeze, but basically it was an early stage bioscience company that focused on research, development, and commercialization of traditional Chinese medicine. And this was to treat neurocognitive disorders and degeneration, specifically ADHD, which is attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and autism spectrum disorder, ASD. Anyways, what was interesting, if it's not just the short squeeze, maybe the market went a bit crazy for Chinese traditional medicine, that kind of natural herbal medicine, and you know how they're using it to treat disorders and diseases out there.
Holy jamole, over the other end of the world, I just wanted to show you this, guys.
This was back in July, this article was released.
And in South Korea, there is a toilet that can turn poo-poo into digital currency. Yes, you can make that moolah.
So using a toilet can pay for your coffee
or buy you bananas at a university in South Korea. Yeah, roses really smell like poo poo poo. Let it fly, my angels, let it fly.
Anyways, back to bingo. This is the tab from a few weeks ago about institutional shares, and we were ranking out of 36,000 shares back then that were being covered. We were about 275th. Today, the accumulation has been significant, and this is now out of 124,000 tracked stocks. We are in the top 600, so we're 597th. What do you reckon by the end of this year? Will we have more than 300 institutional owners? We may even have this, you know, before the end of September. This was another thing that I found you really need to see, and I want to show you what China's up to and how they're going to be making some juicy money. So China's gene giant, BGI, they're harvesting data from millions of women. This Reuters article stated that Reuters has found that BGI's prenatal test is one of the most popular in the world, is also a source of genetic data for the company. They've worked with the Chinese military to improve population quality and on genetic research to combat hearing loss and altitude sickness in soldiers. So one man's trash is another man's treasure. BGI says it stores and reanalyzes leftover blood samples and genetic data from the prenatal tests. More than 8 million women have taken BGI's prenatal tests globally. And what exactly are they doing with this data? Well, the findings offer new insight into how BGI is using vast computing power to unlock genomic secrets. And apparently, this is a quote from Anna Puglisi. She's saying, when you combine large amounts of genomic data, including mothers and their unborn children, with their medical data and history, it's really powerful. The number of women globally who've taken the test is 8.4 million. And apparently, some of these NIPT tests can show if the mother has any chromosome anomalies, cancer, an autoimmune disease, a recent organ transplant, or blood transfusion. Also, what they found out so far is now they can reveal 84 genetic conditions that can affect pregnancy of women under 40 and sex chromosome disorders that can cause learning delays. And this is the scary part. Apparently, by collecting all of this kind of data, the large genomic datasets can be used to design disease therapies, but they can also explore susceptibilities in population. So there could be genetic vulnerabilities, and they're saying that an adversary or an enemy could exploit a susceptibility to disease in a targeted genetic attack. So what if they designed a virus and it only affects a certain amount of population or certain types of people with a certain gene? Goodness gracious, that is scary. You gotta use that information for good, baby. Don't get sucked into the deep darkness. BGI has also been up to the most. They've created the largest study of Chinese population genetics ever. They used 141,000 prenatal tests, and they described the test as an untapped resource, and they were trying to understand how people's genes relate to their characteristics as well as their susceptibility to viruses. This is something that also runs in my family, mental health, so the researchers were also able to see genes associated with bipolar disease, schizophrenia, immune response, and resistance to malaria, as well as the genes linked to height and percentage of body fat, as well as to a high diet in animal fat. They were also able to track viruses including hepatitis B, which is relatively common among the Chinese population, and two types of herpes virus, which they said were more prevalent among Europeans. Oh no, that herpes. So we can see that this kind of data, these prenatal tests, they present a new way for people to earn money and to study into disease. So that's some very valuable information coming from a type of test. Currently in genomics, there's a lot of money going into it. Lots of people are receiving finances and funding. On the 2nd of August, this was reported as well, Australia was launching a pilot preventative cancer screening program that offers low-cost DNA genetic testing to healthy adults between 18 to 40. So they're going to collect that data as well. That's going to be worth some money, and they're hopefully going to save a lot of lives. With Bionanogenomics, we've got this expected growth rating of 9 by Chartmills. They expect that we're going to grow 84.18% per year for the next 5 years in revenue. We're going to be growing and accelerating. Smoke them, leave them in the dust. And with them, they're having a relatively kind of conservative estimate of $172.2 million by 2025. It could even be a lot more than that. We could get a lot more adoption in the next coming years. We're healthy. We have cash in the bank. Bingo is financially healthy and little risk of bankruptcy at the moment. And this kind of cash runway, I think we've got $332 or $33 million in the bank. We're sitting on this kind of war chest. Will we have enough cash to build out and make sure that we get on our roadmap towards adoption globally? I want to show you some big boys that are also exploring, and they also own Bionanogenomics Sapphire. So if you can see here, King's College London, Nvidia has actually launched and come into the genomics scene. They're launching Cambridge One AI supercomputer to spark life sciences research. So over here in the UK, Nvidia's launched this artificial intelligence powered supercomputer, enabling researchers to study in digital biology and genomics. They're putting $100 million investment forwards. And who is it being conducted
conducted by, you can see, AstraZeneca, GSK, Guy's and St. Thomas's National Health Service Foundation Trust. Here we go, King's College London. And Oxford Nanopore is also getting involved, but King's College London, this is important. King's College London is also attached to King's College, the hospital, as you can see here, King's College Hospital in London, NHS Hospital, a big site for research. They have a large laboratory, and actually this is a key site within the UK, and they adopted the Sapphire earlier in 2021, stated here, April 21, 2021, they adopted Bionanogenomics Sapphire. So what are they using this AI to look for? They want to collect all of this data, as much data as possible, get a better understanding of brain diseases. They also want to develop new drugs, and they want to improve the accuracy of locating disease-causing variations in human genomes. They're willing to put $100 million up front, and they're saying, you know what, run with it, baby. This is what we want you to find. We want you to locate disease-causing variations in human genomes. In terms of the genomics market, it's going to reach $94.66 billion by 2028. So there's increasing genomics applications and rising government investments to amplify the market growth. This was reported by B Fortune Business Insights, $94 billion by 2028. One of the biggest boys that ARK Invest exited from, Illumina, has actually been investing a lot. They've invested in 9 genomic startups for a second global cycle. Some of these startups are over here in the UK. They've got these advanced genomic startups in the UK. Some are in the San Francisco Bay Area, some are here in Cambridge. They're all working on different things. Some are working in diagnosis. The other one is to generate innovative medicine, cell therapy, gene therapies. The others are looking at skin health and trying to delay aging, whereas others want to screen for cardiovascular diseases. Investments are pouring and flooding into the world of genomics. Does Bionanogenomics have a unique position in the market? Well, all I can say is, welcome to Cytopia. Larry Raymer over at Investor Place, this guy is long Bionanogenomics. He's saying that Bionanogenomics stock will soar as the company's diagnostic system catches on. The big push will come here. Sapphire's tests will save payers a great deal of money by diagnosing illnesses much more quickly than the standard of care in many cases. Sapphire prevents a lot of unnecessary tests, hospitalization days, and ineffective, unnecessary treatment, all which are very costly. Sapphire is also relatively inexpensive at $550 per genome, and it's going to be getting a lot cheaper. And Larry says that these payers in general and private health insurance companies, they're all about saving money and saving lives. By affordably providing diagnosis of disease earlier than the standard care of devices, Bionano accomplishes both goals. And Larry was saying that he held a long position in Bionano, and he's saying that although Bionano is growing quickly, it's not making that big schmooler yet, but once payers start jumping on board, start reimbursing hospital labs for Sapphire tests, the labs will be more willing to pay Bionano much more for devices and tests, and many more labs will be eager to adopt the system. What is it, financial advice from Larry over here? He said, I advise patient investors to buy the shares at this point. Oh, big boy. This geezer's over on StockTwits at Larry Raymer. Let's send Larry a round of applause for this article. Beautiful, baby.
Hey, Larry, you get a follow, and I'm gonna write you a message, big boy. At Larry Raymer. Juicy article.
Baby.
Where's my cowboy emoji? Send him a cowboy. Send him a yeehaw. Oh, God. Goodness. Too many yeehaws, baby. Hit this guy up, show him some love. I do hope that is the right Larry.
Okay, so we got these events coming up here. European Society of Human Genetics. This could be a place where we can showcase and get some of that data in, baby. We've also got those 11 customers showing some juicy information.
And Brennan, you managed to get the man himself, Yovel, to say thanks, man.
We mapped the human genome for hydroxymethylation as well. And as we can see here, the epigenetic optical mapping of 5 hydroxymethylcytosine in nanochannel arrays. They said that this is a distinct product of active DNA methylation that is linked to gene regulation, development, and disease. So this 5-HMC levels dramatically decline in many cancers, potentially serving as an epigenetic biomarker.
They found another one, baby. Target that one up.
You see, using optical genome mapping and the Sapphire machine, they're always finding different applications for it. And as you can see here, they can find some data that could be life-changing for people, and it can actually innovate towards the future
future and where we go with genomics. I need to read through this properly in order to understand it, but for example, if they are to find, you know, epigenetic biomarkers for certain comorbidities, diseases, and they can use this for early diagnosis, making 5-HMC a potential biomarker for early diagnosis and response to therapy, they can save so many lives, baby, and they can make that shmoney. They were also using optical genome mapping for mice, but why are you looking at intellectin gene family in the laboratory and wild mouse strains? Well, apparently intellectins have an important role in innate immunity and are involved in the etiology of various human diseases, including inflammatory bowel disease. You know what else people have done with mice recently? They've been editing one gene which has extended a mouse's life expectancy by 23%, and they think that this could be the fountain of youth for humans. That's a big, big discovery, baby. So as we can see here, over in Israel, it was actually a lead researcher, Haim Cohen of Bar Ilan University. It's a public research university here in Tel Aviv in Israel. This man was actually looking and focusing his research on the SRT6 protein. It's involved in regulating many biological processes such as aging, obesity, and insulin resistance. So the team over there believes that this could translate to humans having a longer life. If they're able to do this with mice, they think one day they're able to do this with humans. So this is what they found: a longer life. The average human life expectancy doubled in just the past 200 years, thanks to no small part to scientific breakthroughs in medicine, nutrition, and disease. And in future, breakthroughs might allow us to live decades or even centuries longer across the globe. This is what scientists are proposing. The genetic clue was with what that guy was researching, the SIRTUIN6 gene. So what they found was with genetically modified mice, they had the SIRT6 gene, which would produce higher than normal levels of the protein. This gave them a 23% longer life expectancy than wild mice, and this appeared to allow them to stay healthier for longer. They could also run faster, so is this like a superhuman superhero gene that we could be looking at, and run longer distances too? They were also able to overcome age-related diseases such as cancer and blood disorders. One thing that they found as well with the analysis was that the SIRT6 gene allowed older mice to generate energy from sources they normally have trouble tapping into at such an old age, such as fats and lactic acids. So this was the statement by Haim Cohen. He said, if we can determine how to activate in humans, we will be able to prolong life. And with all of that said, all of this data, all of this knowledge is power. How much would people be willing to pay to be healthier? How much would people be willing to pay to prolong their life? Not only that in terms of how much money we can make, but it's actually such a good thing being able to actually preserve life, make sure people are diagnosed earlier and actually get treatment and kind of eradicate these kind of diseases that keep cropping up. What kind of diseases have we seen eradicated? According to Wikipedia over here, two infectious diseases were smallpox in humans and rinderpest in ruminants. So I don't know if you guys have ever also had a loved one that you've lost to some sort of disease or comorbidity like cancer. I treated a patient the other day who actually has CLL, so it's a type of leukemia. But imagine this machine in the future, the Sapphire machine, they're going to be able to map out, they're going to be able to diagnose earlier, and they're going to save a lot more people's lives. And with genetic editing coming along as well, what will we see in the future? How many targeted therapies are there going to be that's going to target so many diseases around the world? So guys, I hope you like this kind of a general exploration of what's going on in genomics and just what I think is going to happen with bionanogenomics and how much I value this company and what I think it's going to be like. And I believe that with the kind of strategy they're implementing at the moment, they will see some big revenue growth in future years to come. I don't know how long the adoption will take, but I know that it's worth it in the long run for me anyway. This is not financial advice, this is only my opinion, and for entertainment only, baby. I'm going to get some rest. If you guys have wondered where I've been, I've actually been in the hospital and I'm looking into genomics within the placement that I'm on currently. I'm a student nurse, I'm on my final placement, and I'm in a really good place that I'm looking at all of the kind of instruments, the machines they're using, the cost as well per instrument. And it's exciting to look at, and I'm learning a lot of skills, and this placement is going to last me for a while, so please bear with me. I'm going to keep grinding out content, I'm going to keep researching, and I'm going to be looking into genomics, and there's currently some trials also being explored at this hospital. It's a university and a research hospital too. If you're able to support my channel, please click the join button. If you like this content as well, you can also send me a donation on PayPal, it's in my description box. I will never send you a number on WhatsApp, just remember that. I will never give you a WhatsApp number to contact me. Thank you so much for all your love and support. Please hit the thumbs up button and click subscribe if you haven't already, and I'll catch you in the next video. Mr. Over and out, baby. Go.